did you get involved with Rob?
Rob Zombie was a guy, it was an entirely irregular audition. There's a casting director that he uses named Monica Mickelson here in town. She's fantastic. She's an actor's delight. And you go in and she is pulling for you. She brings in people she wants to get the job. And there's a lot of us. We all three might be going for the same gig, but she wants all of us to get it. And so she's great. She had cast me in a movie called Serving Sarah with Elizabeth Hurley and Matthew Perry. Elizabeth Hurley, Matthew Perry. And
you almost said Hugh Grant.
I almost did.
And
I was thinking of
I felt it, and there's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, and I wanted to say Hugh Grant, and I don't know why.
I think they were together.
Maybe that was the point.
My interesting point in life was that and so she cast me, a director named Reginald, he was Reggie then, Hudland.
Sure.
And I couldn't do the movie. I got entirely sick. Like really sick.
Yeah.
Like that was my bout with death. That was cancer for me. It was leukemia. And I was at MD Anderson Hospital.
What year was that?
That was in
99, 2000. Okay.
Right in there. So Mike Judge did the role. That I was supposed to do.
Well, it was great.
And the big joke was, who's going to get, because Matthew Perry, they had to shut the movie down because at the time, Matthew had a little
97, yeah, that was the
speed bump.
Yes.
And so the joke was, who's going to get,
literally,
who's going to get better first? Who's going to get out of the hospital first? Lou with cancer or Perry with drug rehab? So anyway, Monica always had remembered me. And so when it came time when Rob had gone to her because he trusted her implicitly, she goes, I got a guy. But there were, like I say, there's always some guys. So when I went to the room, there was Steve Zahn and there was Jeremy Davies, and they wanted to do this because they were rock and rollers. And I was like, Rob Zombie's like, you know, he scares me. And so I read, and it was just right. It was right, and he connected and liked me. By the way, he's not there. He finds it very disarming to be in the room. He only casts off tape. He won't be in the presence because he just feels that it's
too intimidating.
It changes the environment, changes the dynamic.
Not him, but that he doesn't measure up to the honor of your talent on display.
Oh, it's the other way around.
Yeah, he's embarrassed to be there judging or selecting you.
Okay.
And he has an incredible respect for actors. And he just finds it easier to let them do their thing with Monica, get a great performance, and then I'll see it on tape. And by her blessing and what I've heard and due diligence, I know this guy's a solid dude. And so I'll bring him in, and I like the gim. And he's never changed that.
Yeah.
And now you're seeing a lot of that happening. It's more of a time efficiency now going on tape, but for him, it's an actual, it's respect.
That's his thing.
Very interesting.
Because the casting thing is just a weird
getting
process.
Every minute.
And getting weird.
From when,
it's really tough.
From if when we started.
Depending on what side of the table you're on.
Where you've been really from weird. And where you've come from.
Yeah.
And where it is today, it's polar opposite of what your approach is.
And I think that's great because, especially with someone like you, Lou, is there's some good feedback from that, because you said back in the now, it has changed. And you've noticed that we've seen it, because you're someone who's done so much work on a wide spectrum of stuff that you're not just in one thing. You're super awesome and fortunate to be, hey, I've done an episode of this, but I did, you know, a series of that, I did this movie and that.
I think it's, thank you, I so appreciate that word taste.
Well, that's
because
the,
that is,
you had that taste of
that,
it.
That is a something that I think as artists we all aspire to, is having taste. I mean, just because you play electric rock or you play punk rock doesn't mean you can't really dig some blues or country.
Oh, sure.
So that's the thing, and I feel like we're all a little bit like that, and Rob's no exception. So he was looking for a little gunslinger like me, because essentially that's who he is. And I'm sure he loved Davies, and I'm sure he loves Zahn. How can you not? But I just, in that instance, nailed it. So when I say nailed it, he liked me and he picked me. When he did.
Is that what's for Devil?
Devil's Rejects.
Yeah.
When he did, and Monica said, it looks like it's going your way, I was rather nervous because I had never experienced the horror genre. I had never set foot in it.
Until that?
Other than as an audience member. And I wasn't what I would call a huge audience member. So it wasn't that I was, oh, great, I'm going to do this. I mean, when I read that script, I was like, oh, my God, can you really do this on film? And I was actually nervous, and I had, because I wasn't sure it was right. I just had never done anything, and I didn't know exactly what it was. And so I called a good friend of mine, a brother from the South, Walton Goggins.
Yeah.
Who had done House of a Thousand Corpses.
Sure.
And by this time was starting to really...
I love his death scene in that film.
It's the
so
perfect,
fucking great.
It's the perfect piece between both of those movies.
Oh, my God.
And it's my favorite piece of that movie. I prefer Devil's Rejects to House of a Thousand Corpses.
I prefer it, too.
But
I
that
love
scene is exceptional.
House of a Thousand Corpses because, it's, to me, it's like a starter kit to, like, what
it's
zombie
film
does.
School.
Yeah.
Yeah,
for sure. I mean, I love it, and I love all the actors in it.
Yeah.
Hardwick's even good in it.
He's so great.
Yeah, he's great in it. And I love it. Yeah.
And Rainn Wilson.
Rainn is amazing.
Crazy.
But Devil's Rejects is like a masterpiece to
it
me.
It really
like,
is.
A masterpiece of horror.
It was something so special. And I talk about it a lot. We're 11 years now. Walton Goggins said, look. And I said, Walton, I don't know, man. This is... I'm a good Christian boy from the South. I'm going to go work for this devil worshiper, you know. And Rob Walton's like, you idiot. Do yourself a favor. Take this job. It's going to be good work, and you're going to have a friend for life in Rob. And, man, the truer words never spoke. We showed up at that table read, and I didn't know what to expect. I just showed up like any other film. But there was something really unique and special. And there was... everyone was there.
Was it the cast? Or
it was
the
entirely the cast.
Yeah.
No, Rob just kind of snuck in. We all assembled. Monica got us around. It was at Lionsgate, and Monica got us around a big conference room table and just threw the script out. And everybody sat down. And Bill Moseley sat down. And Sid Haig sat next to him. And Sherry was there. And across from them was William Forsythe. Ken Foray, and all of a sudden there's Danny Trejo sitting over there, and then there, you know, there's little me, you know, trying to, wow, these guys, and you know, and I'm sitting next to Jeffrey Lewis, Clint Eastwood's best friend.
Right.
He had a card that said that, hey, I'm Clint Eastwood's best friend.
Get you know, out.
God,
that's
no,
awesome.
It's great. I learned so much from him, and God bless him, and I miss him. He passed just 2 years ago, and Juliette Lewis's daddy. Mm-hmm. And there was something about that table read, and it was Sid and Bill, and they brought their A game to a read, and that doesn't always happen at a table read, because everybody's sort of...
Try to pound through it.
Yeah, let's get through it, and I'm not going to show all my cards, and I'm not even really sure, I'm a little wobbly on skates right now, but on the day, I'll be playing net, I'm okay, but not this time, and Bill and Sid went at it, and Forsythe wasn't going to let him run away with it, so he raised the bar, and all of a sudden, that reed was singing.
Wow.
I mean, it was like the jam session with the band, man, and it was Pearl, and Roger
someone,
sat
someone
back and said,
yeah.
Well, they could have, but so, that was where it started, and then it never fell down on the entire shoot. It always was that thing. And
just like something just like came together.
It was perfect, and I do give a lot of credit, A, to Rob, because he assembled that cast. Monica Mickelson helped him. B, to the pros, Moseley, Haig, Forsythe, Foray, Trejo, Jeffrey Lewis, Brian Posehn, Dave Sheridan. Everybody in there kind of raised their game. And Bill and... I remember specifically moments working with them that they were acting different than how I had acted on television or film, and their work was different. And what it was, they have this, it's hard to explain on air, but they have this movement, this ever so slow and methodical creep into your
personal space while you're doing the work. And they may not even be talking to you, but they're just leaning into you, and you start to feel yourself being invaded with their presence, and you either push away or you butt up against it, and it causes this tension in almost the room and the scene, and the camera then wants to get in and see what's going on, and you see the DP's working harder and focus is going and something else is happening than besides what's blocked. And every time Sid Haig was able to do this, and Mosley would do it as well, and they would tag team you and get you like, you know, wolves in this.
Do you feel like that's a conscious choice?
I was about to say, you think it's conscious or something that just organically happens because of the energy between
room? They know.
It's a technique.
Yeah.
And the end result is the devil's reject.
If Val Kilmer was standing there, he would say, "This is weird and different." Or, you know, both
of you. And he's
both,
weird and different.
But both of you have been, you know, on camera and worked a lot. So you as much as you've worked, you would say, "Holy shit, this is different." And this isn't horror film acting, but there's something Lugosi, Vincent Price, Argente.
It's creating a presence.
There's something going on there that doesn't just happen with the rest of us, Patrick Wilson or whoever drops into a horror film.
Right.
You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
And that was particularly special.
That's what I love about his particular style of filmmaking, zombie-wise. I mean, he just feels like it's an homage in a certain way, but also
new.
It's, there's a fresh take on it.
Yeah.
You know, even 31, you know, it's like, what the fuck am I watching right now?
You know, I feel like Rob's, we talked about this.
And I love you, but I am terrified of you right now.
I haven't seen 31 yet. You're talking about, hey, okay, great segue, because that was a great intro, and that was Rob Zombie and Devil's Rejects. But, hey, it's us.
Oh, hi, I'm Ryan Lambert.
And I'm Andre Gower. This is Squadcast.
Squadcast.
And you got kind of right in the middle of an ongoing conversation with our guest today, the fantastic face and voice actor, Lou Temple. And we are sitting in Lou's awesome house. He invited us over today, and so we were talking. So we were in the middle of the story, so thank you for hanging out and inviting us over.
Oh, welcome. Okay. You're here.
Let's just get right back into it.
Yeah,
because
our folks
just kind of, they're in the room with us hanging out. So you were talking about 31.
I feel like it's sort of like, you know, that Scorsese camp or something. Like, once you're in, you're in.
Yes.
So now you're in every Rob Zombie movie.
I've had the good fortune to have worked with him a lot and to grow with him.
Character.
Yes.
So for 31, did you develop that
with Rob? So his work is this. He frames the house. And so he's got the blueprint, he's got the design, he's kind of the architect, the designer, and he lays the foundation and he puts up the posts. But then he's really bringing you in as the drywall, the finish painter, the electrician, and you do the finish work. And he brings you in to bring something. You bring something to the party, and that's his expectation. Even if he doesn't know you well, his decision to bring you into the team is based on, I think you're bringing something, because he doesn't actually want...
You do what you do, and I'll just film you do.
He relies on what you're going to bring.
But it's got to work.
Sure.
So if it doesn't work, you know what? Maybe I made a mistake. Maybe this isn't working. Let's go a different direction. Or you know what? Let's call it a day. Thank you. And you'll be in the cornfield.
Thanks for coming. Bye.
And that's so harsh. I know, but
he actually wishes people into the cornfield.
And you don't want to be wished into the cornfield by Rob Zombie.
And he doesn't do that.
You're a bad man.
That would be a different. You're in the cornfield.
And so he really likes
Jeremy Lick and Billy Mummy.
Right. And he really wants you to bring something to the party. And he'll often say, "You're the actor. I tried to give you something, and I know lenses. I've learned them a little bit. I know my camera guy.
Yeah.
I know some tone, but You're the actor, and you know what you're doing more than I know what you're doing. So you do your thing. But I will say this about him. He wouldn't say this about himself, but I would say he knows what he wants, and he wants what he knows. So you have to, A, bring something and know that it fits. And so I've been able to bring something. I think he and I have a communication that's a shorthand. So I don't have to go, what are you looking? You know, I know when I read it and I go, oh, this is what you want me to do. Why do you want me to do that? Why are you? And so, because where he's gone from, a guy like Adam Banjo in Devil's Rejects, who's the victim, and he wanted Adam to be this country guy that loses, you know, essentially. Mm-hmm. But my thing was, okay, well, how about if we build him where a lot of false bravado on the front end, a lot of shit talking in the front, shit hits the fan, he puts his wife's miniskirt on, throws up, and she's got to take care of him. Then he goes out in the field like a limp piece of shit, and all of a sudden he's got to find the mustard to fight, and he does, and we're going to win, and him and his partner, and they don't win, but they go down with glory. How's that? And Rob's like, that seems perfect. Can you pull it off? And I'm like, I can try. Let's see. And so that's how the work is. We go to Halloween. It's like, okay, look, I want Danny to be the sweetheart because there's a payoff here with him and Michael Myers. But you have to be the other side of that. You've got to be the asshole in this movie, the hard guy. And I'm like, well, for me, then that's going to be this, again, shit talker, racist, pushing the card on Danny, but Danny's character, but also trying to get the big guy as a little guy under my thumb, because that'll make me feel better, you know. And so I want to get this guy, Michael Myers, engaged in some of the shitty things that I do, which was the rape scene that was cut from the movie because the Weinsteins felt it would alienate the female audience. So we kind of talk through all that, and you know, so
it's on
you
the
spend
extras though, right?
Yeah, it's on Rob's director's cut. Yeah, and so we spend time working with that, and I'm like, well, Rob, so here's what I'm thinking, and here's where I'm, and he's like, yeah, that works. And I'm like, okay. So, but that means too that you got to spend time with Tyler and say, just so you know, this is where I'm going, and I'm going to try to sodomize you in this room while I get on her as well. That's my intention is actually to fuck Michael Myers in this scene. And just so you know, that's where I'm coming from. Now, you can put a stop to this at any given moment, and that will be your coming out. And that's when, you know, that's the scene structure, or that's the reveal of what we're trying to do here. And so, but Rob's good with that. Then we get to 31, and I thought the guy I did in Halloween was awful, but this thing in 31 is the worst. And he's like, he'll flip the script on you. He's like, I don't want you to think about where you came from or who you are, or daddy did this to you, or you're this guy. I just, when I'm on stage, and you know this, Rob tells me, and I'm in makeup, I am not Rob Zombie, but I am Rob Zombie.
Yeah, you're right.
And so all of a sudden this becomes different.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you, because you mentioned before that this wasn't really a genre that you were familiar with when you were like growing up or whatever.
No.
So like as an actor, and you're thrown into these roles, how do you sort of like, I mean, what's your take on that? I mean,
yeah,
because I mean, a lot of people be like, I would know exactly what to do. I know how to do that. I know how
because I saw this movie and that movie.
Right.
And this is exactly what.
Yeah,
that.
Right.
So
that
how
works.
Do you do that as
none
an actor? Because you also
me.
Like,
yeah.
were you've done numerous amounts of other things
yeah.
that have nothing to do
I
with that.
I have to ground things into reality. So, you know, I guess if you want to call that method, you can. I guess if you want to call that sense memory, you can. But something has to connect with me
and what I'm
doing.
It's just personal.
Yes.
Yeah, like, right.
So I can't.
The villain never thinks that he's doing anything wrong.
Which I always try to give. I try never, the old cliche, don't judge your character. I try not to judge him. I try to give him. I try to start every character to understand that all of us were sweet little boys at some point.
Mm-hmm.
you know, I mean, I don't play too many supernaturals. I've done a couple, so I don't have to worry about, you know, I'm this benevolent demon. But
right. in everybody was an 8-year-old kid at one point.
A really sweet guy. So yeah. How did it go astray? Mm-hmm. And I can't rely on DNA or, you know, destiny or whatever. So I have to rely on whatever that is to build a backstory. So okay. Somewhere I've got to focus on things that have been in my life that are not nice, haven't been good, or that I can connect with. And they certainly aren't killing somebody or maiming somebody or getting killed or getting maimed or getting hurt. But they are things that emotionally really affect me, that break me, that I don't want to have to revisit. But those are the best sources of content for me to serve whatever emotional presentation I have to go to. So I will spend time there. Rob asked me on Devil's Rejects, if you saw a guy get his head blown off, your roadie, what would you do? I said, I would immediately throw up. I just think I would just react. And there again, I spend the whole day throwing up Campbell's chunky,
yeah. Yes.
Chunky clam chowder.
The ultimate special effects prop.
And so...
I used it in college, by the way. I'll show you the video.
Yeah, and I've come to learn to understand that these guys... I've certainly seen a lot of racism, so I know where that comes from. I've certainly seen a lot of desire and avarice and shameful greed and those things, so I know where that comes from. I know what poverty conscious is, and so I think I bed guys...
You're drawing.
I think I bed my players into places that people can connect with because they understand, and I'm drawn to that. So if this guy's just an asshole, that's not enough for me. It's... Right. Why is he an asshole? When wasn't he an asshole?
There's a great line in 31 I kind of connected with today when there's a huge like monster killing scene, and then one of the guys gets cornered, and he's like, "I'm just like you. I don't want to really be doing this."
Yeah.
You know, and I was like, there was like a weird like, "Are you this?" Who's puppeting you? Like, who's doing this? And I was like...
So that would be one of the things that specifically I made a choice that I wasn't going to do that. I wasn't, because there was a lot of instances...
You're just
going
to go all in.
I recognized... I didn't talk with everybody. That was my brother, David Urey, who's fantastic, that played Schizo Head. And I realized... We had talked a lot because we had a relationship and a rapport on set, and a friend. We have a friendship, and so I realized that's what he was going to do. And I just wanted to be that guy that wasn't. And getting back to the makeup and the masks, Rob wanted in this instance not to make it too cerebral. He really wanted. He's always wanting to stretch us, his ensemble. And so for me, what he wanted to do in this case, I want to take away your reason by just putting makeup on you, and you are not you.
You're not you in 31.
I want
to
see.
I'm like, is that Lou? Am I going to see this guy in like a couple hours?
Yeah.
I think I'm going to
kill
myself.
Yeah, no, he said, I don't, by the way, don't, he's like, I'm disturbed right now.
Yeah.
So I can't wait to actually see it.
And so he said, I want to see where that asshole,
like,
and not where.
In blood.
I don't want to see where he comes from. I just want to see where he goes. From the minute, I don't want to see anywhere he comes from. I just want to see when you walk on that set. And so the only thing I asked him...
So it's up to you to decide where he's coming from?
Yeah, okay. And so that told me right there, because then I really understand what Rob's trying to do. He didn't have to say, we've done that. He said, I don't want to see racism. I don't want to see, but I do want to see something we haven't seen out of you, and that's why I've invited you back to do this. Otherwise, you'd be one of the victim guys, which you've done. So I realized that, and the only thing I asked him, and he and I do this often, because we love music, we play music, and I said, and I typically try to have a soundtrack for every character, and particularly one song.
Interesting. Okay.
That fuels the movement.
It's a great thing to set a movie.
Fuels the guys
that you choose.
that I choose. And that goes from The Walking Dead to all the zombie stuff. And so I said, and I was struggling with this because when I did put that makeup on, I recognized, oh.
This is different.
And
so what was your?
Well, I had to, typically I don't have to ask, but for some reason I was, this is going to sound bizarre, I was stuck on Elton John and Benny and the Jets.
Ooh, good.
And Rob, I asked Rob, and he was like, love it, but that's not it for me.
Right. That's not for him directing it, but...
But he goes, like, I wouldn't think. He goes, when I go take stages, Rob Zombie, it's not Benny and the Jets. Hmm. And I'm like, right. And I'm like, I might have to ask you. And he said, there's a little band from back in the 80s, I think, Ram Jam. Mm-hmm. And Old Black Betty seems to be the perfect chicken finger. You know, and that was so great. And then I took that even, I put that on acid, and I think it's Spider Bait does a version with an electric banjo, mm-hmm. which is so good. And so that was my, to the point, and this is the kind of, this is where, what I do, and God, thank God Rob does this for me, and Tony Scott allowed this. I will get the sound guy to get his wall of speakers before scene, play that song, and we will play that so that...
This is what I was going to ask. My next question.
The entire crew, not the cast that's going against me, not those people that were, when they were sitting there at that dinner table and we come out with the chainsaws and through the smoke, but the entire, all the grip scaffers, electricians, lights, sound, makeup, hair, everyone on set, Rob Zombie, are getting the vibe of what we're trying to do. And that, so it's almost a music video, so everyone's like, yeah.
Everybody's, you know, bathed.
Everybody's, because what I like, when it's good, when it's really good, everybody's there, and they're all focusing that energy, and they're not here going, cut, oh shit.
Right. Oh shit, I gotta go change the lights.
This is what I've been wanting to ask this to someone that's worked with Rob for a long time, is... Number one, I mean, yesterday I watched 31, and like the end is Dream On. And it's just basically, it's like Clint Eastwood back and forth with eyes with his wife. And it's who kills who. He throws out the two switchblades, and you're like, are they going to duel? And then it ends, whatever.
Yeah.
Not giving anything away, I guess.
You mean you're not spoiling something for once?
I just totally spoiled the end of 31. But,
wouldn't be your
also
first.
At the end.
But wait, it really does, it doesn't end. So.
No, but he has a history really of spoiling end. Movies. Yeah.
But at the
he
end of Devil's Rejects, it's like Freebird. Yeah. Does he have that in mind pre?
He wouldn't tell you.
And do they play that on the set while they're doing that? Because, I mean,
the end of
Devil's Rejects, when they're driving in the car and like,
yeah, it's so
it kicks up.
It's perfect.
And then like their guns come out.
Yeah,
and it's in slow motion, but the music kicks up.
And
the contrast is
what he will tell you is he'll tell you, I'm looking for something that has the poignancy of Bonnie and Clyde at the end.
Love that.
And that's where we're trying to go. I am gonna say that we want an ambivalence here, where we don't know what's happened and we don't know what we should do. I want people walking out of 31, not sure what, should we be hoping that she made it or hoping that she got killed, you know?
Was he holding up the switchblades to give her one too for a fair fight?
I think he
was. We don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. But it also lends itself to that open end for, a sequel. And
32.
You know? And so, yeah.
Damn it. We've been doing this too long.
Best day of the month. So, you know, he's brilliant that way. I feel like because
it seems like he's just having fun with this, though.
He loves movies. I think he loves the moment on set. This was difficult. Out of everything I've done with him, this was the most difficult.
31.
We had less time. confined space, a lot of art direction, a lot of physicality. I feel like we didn't have near the rehearsal time in front of camera, camera blocking, a lot of, you know, two cameras on the move, and it was a lot of choreography, and I felt like it was a lot of pressure on all of us, and physically it was a lot, and we just didn't have as much time in 20 days to shoot as we did in Devil's Rejects. Now, Devil's Rejects, we rehearsed a lot, and we built things and took a lot of time, and let's not forget about Rob Zombie. That guy is a performer more than anyone in this room or anyone that you actually, and if you've seen him on stage, he is 180. How he does that night after night, I couldn't physically do it. And he is in great shape. He is focused. He is a health conscious person, rock star. Doesn't drink, doesn't smoke, eats very healthy. All the things that entirely disappoint you about a rock star, or at least my generation.
Right.
With my first concert, I was like, where's the Jack Daniels? Where's the hookers? Where's the blow?
What was your first concert? By yourself, not with your parents.
No, him. Just my first concert.
Oh, his, for him.
For him, when he invited me, and I'd never seen him.
But what was your first
concert? Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Yes! At the Astrodome, where was it?
No,
where
it was in Lakeland, Florida, of all places. And I was
even
like,
better.
Yeah,
I worked with Philip Bailey.
That's so cool. I think it was when they were doing...
he was Rasan's brother on Kids and Bullets.
Was it... it was with the robot. Was that Let's Groove Tonight?
September.
I love that song. So when you talk to Rob, when you do interview him, ask him about ABBA, and he'll go, "Oh, favorite band."
When we interview,
and so
that'd be fantastic.
Those are the essence of him. Hammer.
I want to go back to your earlier the little work. Like you worked with Alessandro. Like you did 91 grams, right?
Yes, 21 grams.
21 grams. Sorry,
is
you said 91 grams.
Yeah,
thank.
Aren't you a greedy little
thank
shit?
Thank you, Jameson.
Yeah.
Sponsored by
91 proof.
91 proof. 21 grams.
21 grams. 91 proof.
21 grams.
Edit.
I know. Good point. Hold on 1 second, because you mentioned something, and because we've spent great time on Rob Zombie, which, like you said, is almost a whole other thing. But you said Rob Zombie is a performer, and he has a focus as that guy.
If
you look at, there's very few individuals, I think, that are that crossover performer. That's one key trait. They all have this really different mental aptitude or focus factor that's not just the guy hitting some power chords and screaming into a mic. And that, I think, Zombie's translated that into a film career.
Entirely.
And that's what we have
what
today.
What he does not appreciate is, and you can, as producers, you can appreciate this, is... he does not look forward to the build, and that's the green light, and that's the mayhem of trying to get something made.
He just wants
because you have to remember, and you do know this, that Rob Zombie comes from a generation, and he is a bootstrap guy. He is not. There's no nepotism tied into that, and so he is a guy that made it himself. And so if you're a guy that's like, if I were to say, hey Rob, I'd like to get into the horror directing business, he'd say, go do it. I'm not going
to
help you.
I give you my
blessing.
Yeah.
But I'm not going to put my name on anything you do.
Right.
Don't bring me a script. Do it your way,
please
yourself.
Don't bring me a script.
Because that's what I did, and that's how it's done. And so when he directs you on set, and there's some intense scenes, and Rob's sort of describing it, you start to see where it comes from. When you stab him, what I want you to do is put the hilt in, get it all the way to the hilt, and then twist. Twist it to you, so you're like doing that curl, okay? So stab and twist, and then yank it out, and all of a sudden you're like,
I'm extremely detail oriented.
Yeah, I'm a little. And he has this really interesting thing that I always say. He's about my size, you know, but he has this thing where he likes he likes big guys around him. He likes really tall, big, towering men. You know, I would go on to Devil's Rejects and see Diamond Dallas Page, and you know, and Trejo's really thick, and Forsythe is a pretty big guy, and Sid's a big guy, and Ken Foray's a big guy, and Berryman's tall, and all of a sudden, you know, these guys are pretty big, and Tyler Mane and Halloween's a big dude, and so it's very interesting. And yet, I think that it's even more interesting. Rob's at a place now where he could go to the A-list realm, not to dismay any of our talents, but if all of a sudden Robert Downey Jr. wanted to do a character in a horror film that was directed by Rob, probably could broker that. And he very seldom, I don't know that he feels that he could do that.
But when I go out, your auditioning process, he may not even put himself in the room.
When I go out into the world and do movies with Johnny Depp, they ask me about Rob Zombie and what's he like.
Awesome.
And I recognize you're asking me this because you might take an interest in working. And I relay that back to Rob. And I'm like, you know, Depp asked me about Devil's Rejects and stuff. Have you ever thought of, you know, he's not just going to work with Edward Scissorhands. You know, he's not just going to do, he could be something
you've
different.
You've done two movies with Johnny.
Yes, I have done two with Johnny. And he's his own phenomena. These guys are.
They are.
And I feel a little blessed about all of that because I'm recognizing we were talking about the change, and never more has there been more change. And y'all, the two of you have been in the industry for a long time, and you have recognized it, but never more than like the last 8 years.
Yeah, it's been a really paradigm shift.
The change so accelerated.
Yeah.
And so different. So when I start to recognize, wow, I've worked with some guys that there will never be again. We'll never do that again. And when I talk about those guys, I might talk about the lions of Bruckheimer-style blockbusters. And for me, that would be Tony Scott making movies like Top Gun, Man on Fire, California, and for me, Unstoppable, Domino, Deja Vu, or Gore Verbinski from Pirates of the Caribbean, you know, all of those two. For me, it would be Lone Ranger and Rango, which we won an Oscar for.
Yeah.
Working with a guy like Johnny Depp, who's played at that level, and I've never worked with someone like, let's say, Ryan Gosling. I've met Ryan. He's lovely and adorable. But even working with someone like Tom Hardy, I can tell you there's a difference.
Did you work with Tom?
Lawless.
Yeah, Lawless.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
And so,
Taboo? Have you watched?
I haven't seen it yet, but I hear it's monster. And he's monster. So when I talk about him
working, it's a level. It's a different level.
It's just a different system.
Yeah.
Why is that?
Why are you on that level?
Why can't?
It's not that there's because I want to. What I want to do.
The depth system is a different system. And Hardy's a little on the slide, but the Gosling system.
But Depp just got to that system on a whim. Like, I mean, he just
I think someone like
to be a pirate, and he was like, "I'm gonna fucking do what I want."
Well, Depp always had something different.
And it was amazing. He did something crazy, and then he was this. It's like it was great on.
Look,
because what's funny, you talk about Johnny Depp, Edward Scissorhands, and taking Tonto to a whole other level of where you've worked with Depp. My Johnny Depp experience is signing autographs at the Sherman Oaks Galleria with the cast of 21 Jump Street.
Hilarious.
When I was 14 years old.
How about that?
Because we were both on original Fox shows when they were a brand new network. And then Depp's this kid who's great looking, really good on a really kind of avant-garde show.
Yeah.
That says, I'm leaving
in the
because I'm doing, I'm on a hit show. And I'm the guy in a hit show, but I'm out. And everybody thought he was absolutely bonkers.
We saw that and we didn't even understand.
That's that different level.
Yeah.
But I want to go back to, I thought it was great to start where we did, but I'd like to go back to Lou before you started doing this because you have some cool history.
Yeah.
And not to get too much into, you know, family life and all that, but, you know, just elevator pitch where you're from and what you did because you have some experience with sports. That I think is a different level that ties into your question of where's that level, because I want to touch on something like that. So start early, you know, you're from You're from New Orleans,
Louisiana, and grew up a great place. Yeah, grew up there.
But you can't get immersed in more different stuff than something like New Orleans.
Well, I feel like the pageantry and the revelry of what life is just in general lends itself to feeding the imagination. There's just an inherent cultural exchange that's there amongst the people. There's a soul, there's a vibe, and so all of that.
Unlike anywhere else in the country.
In my opinion.
Everybody thinks New York's this like gravity center of culture, but something like New Orleans,
I think
it's so singular.
Yeah, I think there's a community. I think New York is a metropolis
and has an identity and an attitude.
Absolutely.
But New Orleans is a community.
So when we get together for the Inner Sanctum of Mardi Gras, that's something that is about passing tradition on to the belief system of the young people. We believe in kings and queens. They are going to ride into your life. You might be one of them, and we're going to hail them and raise them up and be proud of them and be proud of our community. And so that's what the Inner Sanctum of the Mardi Gras is. And then we're going to shut it down, and we're going to fast because we're going to patronize our belief system, our religious belief system. So there's that. But life in New Orleans is a toilet bowl swill. So you just keep going around. There's no reason to leave. Why you want to go out and be a movie star, a writer, a musician? We got great musicians here. Go play with the Neville's down at the Bon Ton. And you know what? You don't have to make any money because we'll take care of you. And then when you get some money, you pay us. And it's just the barter system. And you really have to, Harry Connick, John, you've got to get out to get on it, or you're going to get caught up in the swill, which, you know, I don't know how many of the New Orleans musicians you've played with, but most of them are just happy being at home, and that's life. And
interesting.
And until you get away, you don't really get your ambition card. I'm going to go do something.
Until you're out of that centrifugal force.
I'm going to go be an actor. I'm going to write. I'm going to go. And people come there for source information, but they don't. The locals don't leave. Mm-hmm. So there's, you do that. But for me, other than my family being musicians, trumpet and horn players, my granddad, my uncles, and those people, and I realized that probably was what I should be doing. But there was something that said that's not what I want to do, or I want to do something different. And for some reason, as a young boy, when my granddad took me to a baseball tryout for Little League, it just caught my heart. And I think I was just at a place where I need something. And it needs to be different than granddad.
What was your position?
I was just a little guy that didn't have a position, but I had my granddad's mitt from the 1930s. And all the other kids had like regular real gloves, and I felt very ashamed. So much so that I went and I lost that club on purpose so that I'd have to get another. Now that club was an antique. I mean, that club would be worth a lot of money today. But I threw it under in a levee just so that I could go get a new glove. I love baseball. So baseball's been my passion, or is my passion to this day. The lovely thing about baseball.
So you're a total Dodgers fan.
No. I respect the Dodgers. I appreciate them.
And that we live here.
I appreciate that I get to go down to a beautiful stadium.
So baseball entered your life.
And it took a hold of me, and it absolutely captured me the way film captured you, and music has captured you as well. Because baseball was a source of research for me. Where did these guys come from? What's on the back of their baseball cards? What do these numbers mean? Who are they? And who came before them? Who's this Babe Ruth, Ty Cobb, Lou Gehrig guy? What did they do? Who are the Yankees of the 20s? What? Okay, I'm going to go back even further. 1876? What? The Cincinnati Redlegs? Okay, I'm going to learn all about that. I'm going to read whatever source material I can get to. And then once a week on Saturday, there was a game of the week, and I'd watch that, and I'd take copious notes, and then I'd go out and play. So I was both this egghead nerd student, book study, but then physically I was out there playing as much as I could, and I was a little guy, so I had to learn the game from a skill perspective. I
because physically I couldn't strength-wise get around that. So
right there
my approach was aggression. I was a hustler, but also very smart on the field. The two things I could do is I could run and I could throw. The rest of the stuff I had to learn. And so I recognized that baseball is a sport of skill, and you can develop your skill set, which I continued to do all the way through high school. And when it was time to go to college, none of my locals said, hey, come play for us. And I was heartbroken that LSU or Loyola or Tulane didn't ask me to, you know, Southwest Louisiana didn't ask me to come play. None of the Texas teams wanted me. You know, I was just a little middle infielder. So a small liberal arts school in Florida invited me, called Rollins College.
I know Rollins well.
You do.
Yeah.
And so they invited me on a baseball scholarship, and I went down there. Little did I know what a college that was, that it was the Harvard of the South, that it had an incredible student body and an incredible alumni and all those things that I didn't care about because I was on the baseball field. Mm-hmm. So I studied economics because every other player studied economics and passed the test from one guy to the next.
Right.
Business. But looking back on it, when I look back on it, and I'm invited now as an actor to come speak at their theater school that was headed up at the time by Fred Rogers, Mr. Rogers.
Mr. Rogers, yeah.
And Olympia Dukakis, and that was sort of their faculty there, and I was like throwing rocks at the theater fags, and I shouldn't say that, but that was the truth, and so I don't do that now because that would be a hypocrite. I tell them politely, look, I didn't study any theater at your school, but I respect it, and I'll send some money, but I don't feel that I can come talk to it.
Right.
But I played baseball, and then my junior year, I got drafted, lo and behold. And I'd grown just enough where people thought I was going to grow a little bit more. He might make 6 foot. And Seattle Mariners took me. And I didn't, I never did grow. And I was a switch hitter. I ran good. I was fielding good. And I was trying to learn to hit. And I hit three ways, left-handed, right-handed, and seldom. And so I did go back and finish my degree because I promised myself that I was going to do that. And I think that just spoke a lot about who I am. And because I went out and I saw these men playing baseball with me, and I was like, man, am I gonna cut it? I'm gonna try, but I gotta have a fallback plan. So one day there was a little boy playing with us. He was just this scrawny kid. We were all Kauai college guys that were gonna go to the big leagues next year, but all the suits, all the executives were there. I was like, what the fuck, man? And then he swung the bat, and there was this sound. I'm not like that. And there weren't many like Ken Griffey Jr.
That's what I was going to ask who it was.
And so
okay.
that
so.
Was the moment that I realized, how do I survive? How do I keep in this thing that I love doing? Because that's what it takes. And there's nothing like that guy. So that's what it's always been for me. And that is a skill of observation.
But it's two things, because I couldn't have written this outcome any better. And Lou's amazing, because you talked about what that different level is when we were talking about actors. There's a different level. And in sports, there's just a different level.
There is.
You found a sport.
Yeah.
You were intrigued by it. You had to work hard to do it. I did too.
Yeah.
But there's two different types of athletes.
Yeah.
There's guys that are just naturally good, that can go out, go through the motions and be good.
Yeah.
And then there's students of the game.
Entirely.
You became a student of the game on both sides of baseball, learning the history of it, the fun, and then you had to learn how to find your niche in there. It parallels, because I did the same thing. I chose not baseball, even though I was a much better baseball player.
Oh, interesting.
I chose the sport to play. I left a career acting in Hollywood to go play the one sport in college that everybody said I wouldn't be able to. I played basketball in college.
Oh, hoops. Wow.
So I'd always been a hoops fan. I'd always been a natural athlete.
Yeah.
Played hoops and had the opportunity, but I had to go out there, find that school that wanted me to go through a connection.
Recognize your skill set.
Recognize what I can bring.
I can pass, I can set up.
And I'm going to work my ass off.
I can run a court.
I'm going to run faster and harder than anybody else. I'm going to dive on every floor.
I'm going to drill. I'm going to out-drill everybody. And the coach is going
to... And I'm still never going to be as good as the guys that are just naturally gifted.
Yeah.
That can go out there and go through the motions and score 20 a game.
That's just because you're a midget.
Well, yes. on a baseball, it's about power and speed and whatever. But no, at that time, they wanted power and size and speed, and it's crazy.
I mean, it's impossible.
But that different level, and yeah. I love the fact that
so when you went to college, you recognized right away, and so you must have recognized, how do I survive?
I knew how to survive.
Okay.
And especially where I was in my first application of that. I went to a small private JUCO in North Carolina.
Yeah.
That was coached by this old school guy. And to be a college athlete, especially basketball, I was born in the wrong decade.
Sure.
And I've always known that,
yeah.
But I love it. And if I could have chosen a time to play college basketball, it would have been like 1967 to 1971.
It would have fit you a little better.
Because the game was still fundamental, but the game was changing because the athletes were coming. The game was being more athletic. It was becoming...
So the great athlete then was Maravich.
Correct. But the new athletes that were so phenomenal were changing the fundamentals of this game. I'm a fundamentals guy.
All of a sudden, that Artis Gilmore and that Dr. J and those guys were starting. I would have loved that NBA thing was starting to happen. And so we were seeing less Jerry West, who was a great player. But
more of this new...
This phenomenon.
Phenomenon. That's what it was. And... That's what, I mean, created what we have sports. But I resonate with your story about baseball because it was the same thing. I loved playing baseball.
And so...
And all I ever wanted to do was, you know, play perfect, get drafted. And look, I worked my butt off in a private JUCO in North Carolina.
Yeah.
To all I wanted to do was get recruited by a four-year school that asked me to play.
Yeah.
And then that got kind of even jumped up even more because I got asked by a Division I coach to come and be...
That's
to play with my best friend from my JUCO.
That's fantastic.
And it didn't... the end result wasn't as great as it did, but leading up to that was phenomenal. And I was a student of the game. I learned it. I had to work my ass off 10 times. So I love that story.
So
but
you know
there's that guy. I have my
now,
Ken Griffey's too.
You know my favorite thing
it's
about
great.
my passion?
And that's what translates into that.
I don't know
level.
What it is for you, but maybe this works for you, but once a week, I have a dream. I lay my head down, I go to sleep, and I have the same dream that I've been having since I was a 12-year-old boy. It hasn't changed.
Of?
Playing Major League Baseball.
Yep.
I'm wearing the same uniform. I go through the tunnel and take the field in Atlanta.
Okay.
And I run out to shortstop. It's never changed. It's something in my life as I've gotten older. It's the one thing that I've held on from my childhood, and I adore that. It's the same thing that I've had since I was a 12-year-old boy. And at 12, I could wake up and go, it's gonna happen. Today I wake up and go, thank you that I still have it. And that's such a gift. So I play baseball as long as I can in the minor leagues. I get traded immediately from Seattle to the Houston Astros. I get part of their system, a forgettable minor league trade. Only our mothers would know. Doug Givler for me. I get into the Houston system, and I play with some young athletes that are on the move, and I realize I'm still trying to survive, and it's okay. And one day they call me in spring training, and they go, you know what? You're not going to grow. And the Dominican shortstop is like 18 and running just as good as you, and I'm like, I wonder what took you so long. And they go, you're going home.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't have to because we've got this other thing. You like to coach the Gulf Coast League.
Okay.
And I was like, yes, what took you so long to figure this out? Thank you. And so I must have been, I think, at that point, a really good actor. But I was the guy the coaches liked. And on baseball,
and you
were probably that guy too.
I won every coach's award. I never won the MVP. I won the MIP.
Most improved player.
Or most inspirational.
Most inspirational. Which
and
is
the
even,
coach's award.
Which is even better. So,
I'll take those.
So all of a sudden, I'm now picking up guys' helmets. Because that's what you're a janitor.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
As a coach, you're just a janitor.
Yep.
And so... I build this into, and they're like, hey, you got some snap. You're kind of a smart guy. We want you to go with some old boys that are scouts and want you to look for players. And so we start going out. I learn to scout.
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm learning how to evaluate and project future major league players at college and high schools. I'm looking at guys that I used to be. And I'm like, yeah, I don't want to coach. Fuck these guys. You know, the cream will rise to the top. I know that. I'm out.
Right.
But this I like. Give me the choice to go, that guy's a good actor. That guy's a good actor. I want those two. Let me be the casting director of this team. Mm-hmm. And so I did that. And then they're like, you know what? You have good decision making and you collaborate. Oh. And we think you have administrative capacity to be executive. Yeah. So all of a sudden now I'm in Houston as the assistant director of minor leagues and scouting. And I'm heading up two departments. And I've moved on now from that job to be the director of both minor leagues. So every minor league player and every scout guy that we scout, I'm signing off on. And this guy's ready to go to the big leagues and this guy's not. And then one day in Houston, Texas, you can appreciate that, there was a girl. And I followed her into an acting class. And I saw what they were doing on stage. And I hadn't had that feeling in a long time.
Mm-hmm. Baseball, schmaseball.
And I said, wow, I can do what they do on stage. What, I can do that. Well, I couldn't. I couldn't at all. I had no idea. You guys know. And so I went, and I'm like, I think I want to. And I took a leave of absence, and I went to New York, to Brooklyn College, and went and got into an acting program up in Brooklyn.
Wow, that's a big move.
Stanley Zeroff.
Yeah.
And then I came back and worked baseball a little bit and was working and studying and going back and forth in New York and trying to keep this job. And I had this weird experience where Charlie Sheen was in Houston, Texas, doing a movie called The Chase with Christy Swanson.
Yeah.
And you guys were probably in it. And he was preparing for major
manager.
Yeah. He was preparing for Major League Two.
Yes.
And he needed to work out in between his, and so he would come and he would actually, Charlie would lease the Astrodome and play baseball.
Of course he would.
He was working out with me. Because they're like, hey, I hear you're an actor, but you're a baseball guy. And so
right.
So then we go to a birthday party. It's you know, it might have been his 30th. And there's all these producers that have flown into Houston. And of course, it's at a strip club. And it's Charlie's birthday party. These guys, Irby Smith and John Deere, the director of Angels in the Outfield, said, come to our movie. Don't go to carry Charlie's bags and Major League 2. Come to Angels in the Outfield for us. So I took some more time off. And then...
That was kind of one of your first gigs.
It was my first gig.
Yeah.
And so I think I have one line in it. Remember those days?
Yes.
They're still the same today.
Fly ball!
And Matthew McConaughey had like two lines. You know, and Adrian Brody was becoming a little weird star on it, and there was some dude named Stoney Jackson. I'll never forget.
I know Stoney Jackson very well.
I don't know where he came from or who he was or where he went.
He came from the Beat It video.
Yeah,
Stoney Jackson's and Michael Jackson's Beat It video. I used to play basketball with Stoney Jackson on the Hollywood Celebrity.
He was kind of an athlete guy, and he was on that cast.
Yeah,
and so it was
Jerry Curl and all.
Yeah, weird. And Adrian had just done a Burger King commercial, so that was why he was there.
Yeah,
and Danny Glover was like, "Why am I here? It's Disney." And
right.
So, but anyway,
at least it's Disney.
My boss at the time with the Astros called me and said, hey, look, don't worry about coming back. And I was like, uh-oh. And so I go back and I'm like, what's up? He goes, look, you got this thing. Baseball's a lifer. I keep you around. You're just going to stay in this game for the rest of your life. And I don't even know if you're an actor, but I can tell you like it. So I'm not firing you. I'm not rehiring you, and I'm going to kick you out that window. Now, it's your choice. There's a lot of people in baseball. You're well-liked. You'll get a job. But think about following this little spark in your heart. And he said, that's the only reason I'm doing this. Bob Watson. And
well, I'm glad he did, because we're sitting here talking to you now.
And the San Diego Padres called immediately. They said, you want to come to San Diego and be our director of minor leagues? San Diego.
That's a tough gig to turn down when you're in baseball.
It's the perfect view, most beautiful place, single guy.
It ain't Omaha.
And so all of a sudden, I'm like, no.
Fuck those guys.
No, I'm not. And I stayed in Houston, and I ended up working at the Alley Theater on stage and doing Walker, Texas Ranger, and then just continuing. And I kind of caught a little bit of the Linkletter Rodriguez wave. But before they really landed, I mean, right after Dazed and Confused, Newton Boys, and then, you know, Robert was still shooting commercials. He hadn't done Spy Kids or anything yet. He was still trying to get there.
Or and, Il Mariachi.
No, he hadn't even done that. And so, and then Very Happy in Texas, being a regional kind of guy, we never thought about coming out to Los Angeles. We didn't, it wasn't like it is today. You didn't look at...